we keep falling in and out.
Subhanallah.
If there ever was a doubt.
Subhanallah.
Our hearts are so quick to break. At this moment our souls are awake.
Forgive yourself and defy your heart disease. Care for others and give your spirit a release.
We keep falling in and out.
Subhanallah.
If there ever was a doubt.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back to another episode of Moments for the Heart. And I'm your host, Omar Dunlab. We've talked about in some of our previous episodes what is the nature of the heart itself, and I would like to give just a very brief refresher before we discuss today's spiritual ailment and its cure. I would like to give a brief refresher in case some of you have been missing some of the episodes. We talked about the fact that the heart is really a unique physiological aspect of the human being. For example, we mentioned that the top ventricles of the heart, when it beats, it says lub, which is something that means the essence in Arabic. And the bottom ventricles of the heart, when they beat, the doctors have listened to it with their stethoscope, and it says Rab, which means Lord. So we mentioned that your heart is always making dhikr. It's always remembering Allah. It's always praying. But the rest of you has forgotten. Subhanallah. We mentioned also that the heart has 70,000 neurons in it, which are the brain cells, what we call brain cells, but in this case they're heart cells, and that are responsible for thinking. And that sometimes the brain sends messages to the heart, but the heart does not always respond. And sometimes the heart even disobeys the brain. For example, the brain will tell the heart to speed up and it'll slow down, and vice versa. So the heart really is a unique organ. In the Muslim tradition, we believe that it houses the soul, that it's the essence of the human being. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that there is a morsel of flesh in the human body, that if it is pure, behold, the whole body is pure. And if it is corrupt, then behold, the whole body is corrupt. He said, verily, it is the heart. He also said that there is a means of polishing all things, whereby rust may be removed. And that which polishes the heart is dhikrullah, the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What we translate it roughly into English as litanies, small little prayers that we say over and over again a certain number of times, and we ponder on the meaning of them. They could be prayers, they could be glorifying Allah, it could be asking forgiveness, which we call dhikr, or which we call istighfar, excuse me. So, you know, all of these things purify the heart. And we'll talk about dhikr a lot in the later episodes, inshallah, and its effect on the heart, and some really amazing things from the hadith and so on about dhikr, inshallah ta'ala. So I hope that's been a good refresher course for you on the heart and the really amazing thing. And when we say heart, we mean the soul and also the physical heart, and there's some correlation between the two, but we don't get into that because it's very complicated. The spiritual disease of the heart that we will be discussing today, we will talk about some of its signs, some of its symptoms, and we'll talk about its cure, inshallah ta'ala. And that it's a very interesting disease. And even realizing that this is a spiritual malady will bring you peace. You have my word on that. Because we're talking about the disease of the fear of poverty. The fear of poverty. To me, that just that the fact that that's a disease, a spiritual disease that the Muslim shouldn't have, increased my iman. The first time I heard that, it increased my iman. Why? Because I was worried about being poor. When I heard it, I was worried because I had some doctor bills I had to pay and I had this sort of thing. And I was reading in a book and it said, you know, that actually fearing poverty is something no Muslim should have. Because the sound heart, the healthy heart, the pure heart relies on Allah. It has trust in Him. It has complete tawakkul, complete trust that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to take care of it. If you don't have tawakkul, maybe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will leave you to your own affairs, in which case you may fall into poverty. But if you have tawakkul, if you worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as He deserves to be worshipped, praying your five daily prayers, making dhikr, reading Qur'an, trying to be a good person, trying to purify your heart, and you have that tawakkul, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take care of you. You have nothing to worry about. And if you do find yourself in some financial calamity, inshallah, it's just a test. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will deliver you. Be patient, keep struggling, keep striving, and inshallah, you will see that the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala subhanahu wa ta'ala comes. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Al-Quran, His final revelation to mankind, He says that even the messenger and those with him before in history, the messenger, the prophets, have wondered when was the help of Allah going to come. They were distressed and tried so hard. And at that moment, the verse goes on to say, the help of Allah is near. And one of the Sahaba, he used to say that with every relief there is, with every difficulty there is relief, with every hardship there is ease. And behold, when adversity is at its worst, deliverance is near. So even if we were to fall into poverty, we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving us this knowledge that it's something temporary, that it's a test inshallah, and that this whole life is a temporary crucible of trial, and that we will have palaces in Jannah, the likes of which no eye has ever seen. You know, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said about Jannah, paradise, the afterlife, for the mu'min, for the Muslim. He said that a tent in paradise is so many miles high, so many cubits high, and it's made of pearl, and the inside of it is like marble, you know, it's something very nice, something very beautiful, you know, so inshallah we will all be rich, inshallah ta'ala, either in this life or the next, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that when His help comes, that He makes us thankful, because the Quran says that those thankful to Allah, He gives them more. Whereas those who are ungrateful, maybe they're going to receive a punishment or something to that effect. So fear of poverty, the biggest problem with the fear of poverty, being afraid of being poor, is that it means that you have a bad opinion of your Creator. You don't trust Him. You think He's going to be unjust with you in the future. SubhanAllah. The sound qalb, the sound heart, should have complete trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have a good opinion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I will tell you something beautiful, Yahi. I will tell you something beautiful, Ukhti. Something beautiful about having a good opinion of Allah. This is from the book that was written by Ibn Taymiyyah, rahimahullah. He narrates a hadith in one of his books. And he's talking about a man passing over the Sira'at. The Sira'at is the bridge that everybody's going to have to go over. And under that bridge is the hellfire. And some people will fall in. And some will almost fall in, but they'll be able to just squeak across. And some people will go across like a dash of lightning. And their worship of Allah and their good deeds and things is what determines that. Now, according to this hadith that was related by Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, he said that there will be, or Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam actually said, that on the Yawm al-Qiyamah there will be a believer on the Sira'at, and he will be twisting and turning violently like a leaf in a violent wind, and he's almost about to fall in, but at the last second, something comes and saves him, and makes him strong, and is enabling him to cross the Sira'at. And he said, behold, it was his good opinion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. SubhanAllah. This is the power of a good opinion, of feeling good about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of trusting Him, of just, you know, loving Him and believing that He's going to bring something wonderful to you. Not only will that bring you good in dunya, look at the benefit that it will bring you in the akhirah. Has that not increased your iman just sitting here listening to that? Is that not the most beautiful thing you have ever heard? SubhanAllah. So we don't need to fear poverty because it makes you have a bad opinion of Allah Azza wa Jal. Remember also that it's not Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who brings you poverty. According to the Quran, who threatens you with poverty? Shaitan. There's a verse of the Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala informs mankind that it's Satan, Shaitan, who threatens you with fear of poverty, loss of wealth, loss of, you know, land and these sort of things. Don't listen to him. Do not listen to Shaitan. Have a good opinion of your Lord. We should also be very careful about fear of poverty because it could lead to two big sins. It could lead to miserliness, which is a form of oppression. And we've talked about that in some previous episodes. And it can also lead to oppression, you know, because you're working very hard to make sure you have money and you don't care about those that are, you have to hurt to get it. And this sort of thing. So it's a disease that can lead to many sins. So please eradicate the fear of poverty from your heart and have a good opinion of Allah Azza wa Jal. And remember that poverty does not have a right to be feared. Being poor does not have a right to be feared. No creation has a right to be feared. The only thing that has the right to be feared is Allah Azza wa Jal. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's His right that we fear His punishment and that we love Him at the same time. I know some non-Muslims are watching. They don't really like the idea that we fear Allah. But you have to consider the Muslim, the whole picture, the whole Muslim picture of this. We say that everybody should have faith like two wings of a bird. One of the wings is fear. You fear that he will punish you if you do something wrong. Why? Because this stops you from committing sins and being a bad person. And the other wing should be hope, or trust, we could say, that he will forgive you and be merciful with you. Why? And that he will reward you generously for what good you do. Why? Because that motivates you to be better, to work on yourself. And some scholars have even taken it a step further, and they said, but every bird has a body. And so we know what the two wings are, what's the body? And they say the body of the bird should be love. That we love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We love Him so much, and that's the basis of the Muslim's life. Subhanallah, subhanallah, subhanallah. So we will talk about what's the cure for the fear of poverty. We've kind of hinted around it in some of the things that we've said so far in this episode. But we'll remember a hadith of the Prophet, and this is one of the cures. To always remember this hadith, that he sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, remember that righteousness will lengthen your life. In other words, what? Being good, not being bad, you know, worshipping Allah, having faith in Him, this lengthens your life. Why? Why does it lengthen your life? Because this person is the person who has faith in Allah. He doesn't fear anything from Allah except, and he doesn't expect anything from Allah except good. And if he finds something other than good, he knows that it's from himself, and that if he's patient, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will deliver him, especially if he makes tawbah, repentance to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-qawi wa al-qadir. And the person that has this sort of thinking, he is always relaxed. You know, if he really believes that with yaqeen, with certainty, he's always relaxed, he's always tranquil, he takes it easy, and you will find that people love him. The people around him just love to be around him. They say, wallahi, we find peace when we're around you. Or, wallahi, we're always lighthearted when we're around you. You know, we want to be the type of people that people want to be around. And being a righteous person, doing our best and striving our utmost will help in that, inshallah. Remember also that our deen is a deen of risk. You know, our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us how, if we're fearing poverty, how to get increase our risk, how to increase our sustenance. Make a lot of istighfar, right? Being righteous, being a righteous person, as we just mentioned. And this sort of thing. And there's a lot of other things he mentioned. All you have to do is, you know, yourself, do a search online or in a book about how to increase your rizq according to Islam. Have a good opinion of Allah. This will alleviate the fear of poverty. And the last point I want to mention is always, according to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we should always look to those worse off than us and don't look to those better, because that will make you thankful. When you see somebody's going through some hardship, you'll be thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He didn't test you like He tested that person. Okay? And if you're looking to somebody who's got more than you, at least to your perception, and by the way, your perception is probably wrong anyway, it will discourage you and make you have a bad opinion of Allah and so on. So those are the cures, and I hope that it's been a good spiritual journey for you, inshallah ta'ala, and I hope you've benefited, and I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us all among the believers who He loves to meet and who loves to meet Him. Hope to see you next time, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
We keep falling in and out.
Subhanallah.
If there ever was a doubt.
Subhanallah.
Our hearts are so quick to break. At this moment our souls are awake.
Forgive yourself and defy your heart disease. Care for others and give your spirit a release.
We keep falling in and out.
Subhanallah.
If there ever was a doubt.
Subhanallah.
The ultimate fact, if merely in you.
Subhanallah.
That Allah's mercy ever looked after you.
Subhanallah.